said good day, sir!
Welcome back, everybody, here to your coverage of the defense. We're now bringing you the first team to complete all their matches in their group stage. It's four friends plus Krilly. They are playing up in their seventh match right now. Every team must play seven matches here in the group stages. They're going up against a team who basically requires themselves to win against one of the top three teams in their group. If you want to check it out, you can see it right here on the screen or go over to the-defense.com. But we're looking at Group B right now, where Team Empire 4FC as well as Team Dignitas have already secured themselves the top three positions. The question is, who gets that fourth one? MTW. If they win one of these games, then they have the chance. If not, they're going to battle off with the Brazilians, with Kapai, with NSKZ, as well as HWA. These are all the other guys inside their group. Without further ado, let's jump ourselves inside the draft and welcome in my co-commentator, a man who I know has been wanting to join me for a while. And finally, finally, he is here. He will be my teammate in possibly one of the most epic, legendary teams ever. Four guys, one girl, one Dota Cup. We'll be playing later on this month. His name is Durka Durka. How you doing, dude?
Hey, man. Yeah, pretty good. That's going to be an interesting cup later on this month, isn't it? I think we should do pretty well with Slash as our carry.
Well, come on, man. We've got Slash, we've got Purge, we've got me, Problem, we've got Yana, best support in all of Ukraine, and then we've got you on the long lane. Life is simple. Life is good. Life is cracking on. Yeah. Let's check out our game anyway, man. So MTW up against 4FC. It seems like both these teams are not wanting to ban in the usual way, and we'll let Batrider as well as Nyx get through the pool.
Well, yeah, I've been sort of weaving in and out of watching competitive games recently, and every once in a while I see 4FC, and they really do surprise me. I mean, here, picking up Phantom Lancer, I know it's being picked up a lot recently. Na'Vi picking it up, Empire starting to, you know, have a bit of a play with it after Dignitas have showed them how to use it when they got pushed into their base quite quickly with those lances and illusions just, you know, niggling down those racks very quickly. But it's interesting how the picking phase and drafting has evolved over the past couple of months since DreamHack, when we used to see Sven, Magnus permanently picked up. The pool of heroes people are actually using is constantly fluctuating.
Yeah. It's I'd almost say it's also a different it's different styles that people are using that is fluctuating just as much. Like these push harassment tri lanes, and then we've got the aggressive roaming support tri lanes, and then we've got this unbeatable push, which normally comes with like a lone druid and a Chen, and this just melts down towers. And then we have the all-out aggressive kind of like, let's even pick up the Night Stalkers, go diving on towers, look to pick off these heroes in unusual positions, then a huge-ass teamfight lineups. Basically, anything and everything is being used, and this very first start, the only two heroes in the entire European scene which are being consistently banned, and even then, like 3 days ago, I know they kept on slipping through, Darkseer and Undying, the two core ones people keep removing. No matter what happens, they gel into any lineup for all of those. Like, be it ganking, be it pushing, be it teamfight, be it defensive, they work in all lineups, and that's the reason why I keep on seeing them both being banned out. But you are right. Everything just keeps on changing. If you're trying to catch up with the meta scene right now, don't. just don't. just enjoy the games for what they are, and understand the different variations you can have in Dota right now.
Well, yeah, Undying is just a pain to deal with. If you want to try and make pickups, his tombstone annoys you. If you want to try and push towers, his tombstone annoys you. If you want to try and hunt people in the jungle, his tombstone annoys you. Mm. It's just a pain in the backside, that skill.
Yeah, well, I saw a match earlier today during TPL, and I saw the Naga Aldman pop off, and what they do, they walked into the middle of the fight, and they just killed the tombstone, then walked back out again.
Yeah.
And that was it. That was the summary of what the Naga Aldman was used for. Set up, escape. No, we just want to kill off Tombstone and get back out again. Great, fantastic.
Welcome back on cooldown.
yeah, it's not as I like that cooldown is long. Yeah, but yeah, let's look at FTW anyway. So they're playing with their full lump tonight. I know Syndrome's been practicing pretty hard with the boys, and they know what it is to if they can take one of these games. It's such a tall ask, though. It's such a tall ask. to take a game of Empire or Dignitas is one thing. Like, we just saw how Empire threw Virtus Pro to the winds. Of course, that's what happens when you pick Zeus support. turn to ban. If you didn't hear about that, you weren't looking at the Join Dota match ticker. Shout out to all those people out there that use the draft system on the Join Dota match ticker. Oops, that's not sounding great. Yeah, anyway. Let's look at our lanes, man. Let's look at our draft. What do we got so far? PL, Coddle, Batrider. Anything's really doable with this one, but Coddle and PL will always stick together.
It's a really, really age-old lineup, that PL and Keeper of the Light. They used to put it on the long lane as a dual lane so they could have a longer distance to chase people with the slow and the blast, with Keeper of the Light hiding somewhere in the forest, try and rush that Vanguard, get that Radiance up by the 20th minute. And that went on for a year and a half or so back in Dota 1. I mean, whenever you used to play in leagues, either you'd come up against a Phantom Lancer like that or you'd come up against an Alchemist. Radiance was such a common item. Just try and rush that, farm your carry up, and rice the game until the end. But now, you know, we were talking about the fluctuation in game styles, and one thing that I've noticed has solidified, basically, is the use of support heroes now. A lot of people were complaining, maybe, is probably not the right word to use, but European teams using support heroes incorrectly. The Chinese really did show how to utilize your support heroes, get items on them, and actually roam around with them and get the full use out of them. And European teams are starting to catch on. They're roaming, moving around to that offlane to support the offlane hero sometimes, stacking forest, constantly stacking those neutral creeps, getting items on themselves, and supporting their carry at the same time. So people really are catching on to the way the Chinese place very, very solid Dota.
I want to give a bit of an announcement out there that as far as both the live stream as well as the in-game audio, I know Dota TV has been having some issues, both with audio coding going out to, I don't know what regions or where the thing goes wrong. But I do know that, yeah, the stream is fine in a lot of regions. Just play around with the different qualities and you might find one which is a little bit more stable than the other in your region. If you want to know more about that one, look at Toby1Dota on YouTube and I'll explain it in the video which I did with Oh My God, What A Fuck Lag. Yeah, just check out that video. I thought it was rather nicely put. I love this pickup from 4FC.
Yep.
I really like the mixing around with this one. That bear, like, what we've seen. We've seen Brewmasters go up against it to try and shut down the bear. What happens if we have 4 points in Nightmare? And then we also add a Fiend's Grip on top of this one. And this is the way of pulling Nyx out of the fight, pull Shadow Demon out of the engagement. I love watching Baines. I'm really sad that he disappeared as much as he did from the CIS scene. Reserve time.
Not just team fights. Think about laning phase. If they're going to run this how I think they are, try laning that with a PL, Keeper of the Light. Keeper of the Light pulling, stacking in the forest while Bane does some lane harass. The Nightmare into Keeper of the Light channeling up his Illuminate, then Phantom Lancer, Lance. Anyone on that lane they're against is going to get obliterated. They're going to die. Or they're going to get chased down to their tier 1 tower and about 50 health and they'll have to go back to the fountain. But still, they're going to be shoved off that lane and PL will have a really, really free ride.
Yeah, they will. Free riding PL is something you never want to see. We saw it in our last game. We saw it in Quirt versus Na'Vi. And, Havas walked around 23 minutes in with Diffusal Blade and Full Heart. It was... yeah.
He really has stepped up his game recently. I mean, I was watching that Lifestealer game just now. 18 minutes, Daedalus, Mask of Madness, Midas phase. It's just ridiculous.
But it wasn't just him, though. Like, that was the one thing. Like, you look at his CS, and it's not like those times when you look at players like Sylar or any kind of hero, any kind of player, which is able to get this huge amount of farm in a beastick of time. Fear is really great at Black. I still will class as the European king of it. As far as finding farm on a lane. But Havas hasn't really hit that point just yet. A lot of it came with the back of the rest of his team pushing it out. But yeah, let's not talk about that. Let's not talk about that. Let's talk about SF as the final pickup now from 4FC. So now we're having huge amounts of burst damage coming out from Coddle. We've got the SF ulti, which just those two combined does so much damage during a team fight. Bane's locking heroes down. We've got two things that will go through BKB, both Fiend's Grip as well as the Lasso of Batrider. And MTW pick up the Windrunner of Fragile Ranger.
Well, the Shadow Fiend, I don't know, likes to play that. He's got three or so heroes that he's very comfortable with. TA, probably the most notable. I'm not sure why they haven't picked that up for him. Maybe they've been running the Shadow Fiend with that Bane and Phantom Lancer before. I mean, there is a lot of nuking power, as you said, and obviously with that Keeper of the Light, being able to keep the mana regeneration up for the whole team. OD, okay.
Well, what is the one big weakness here of 4FC? Apart from the fact that their big damage dealers are both agility, they're not strength. Where's Sindarin going to find his power? Like, is he, when he drops that ultimate, all the PL illusions are best going to disintegrate in front. The only problem I'm still going to see is the fact that, I suppose, in middle lane, up against Batrider won't be able to spam out as much. That's if OD is heading there. With this lineup, I'm almost feeling that, well, what have we got? We've got Tulex on Windrunner, rather appropriate. Warlog up in the Lone Druid, and Cinderin OD. Yeah, it's going to be OD solo mid if
10
Cinderin goes with what
seconds
is normal. But I'm wondering if this is
5
almost another
seconds
possibility
remaining.
for a setup. We're taking 2 heroes out through Disruption, one out through OD's ability of Astral Imprisonment. It's, yeah. I'm interested to see what a team fight's going to look like because we're going to have
Prepare
people
for battle.
being taken out in so many different ways.
Yeah, if the Shackle latches, then Imprisonment, Banish, Disruption. Then obviously there's a Nyx as well with his stun. If someone gets entangled as well, that's five people disabled on the other side. What are they going to do here? Is Warlock going to go into the forest for a couple of levels first before heading off to that hard lane?
I don't know, man. I would say with Tulex's build, he is set for a solo lane. But
Because
that.
we do see tri-lane with Windrunners occasionally. They
Yeah.
do work out. There's lots of nuking power there, especially with that Soulcatcher and Nyx stun leading up to the power shot.
It normally happens though when you get a large amount of consumables for aggression. Like, we've got one clarity up on SD, and Dutchreath's got one clarity
30
and smoke.
seconds to
So these
battle.
guys are already set. They're staying here in the jungle. They pull a little bit, get a couple of levels up. Mantra, most importantly, is catcher. And then they'll rotate in towards probably middle lane and try and repair the balance that will be there. Because I'm pretty sure Sindarin very early on in his OD is not going to be controlling much. We see Nose. Like, do you go first point up in Shadow Raids or do you go Necromancer? You already know Batrider's going to have an issue to let him have that top lane. There's no problem with that one. And make SF
The battle
go slightly different in
begins.
his build and stack more into Souls and less into Shadow Raids.
Yeah, he's going to need to control that lane pretty well against his OD, especially once he gets that imprisonment spammed on him and OD gets that base damage up with that intelligence. But Batrider, what I'd like to see from Batrider is, going to these two camps. Can I draw on the map?
Yeah,
Can you see these?
I know the ones you're talking about.
People like Bulba, there's a couple of other players that do it from the CIS side. They go over to there, they just get level 3, then head up to that hard lane, and they do have an advantage up there. They can hold their own, they can actually possibly get a couple of kills against those squishy supports.
The only downside is it does stop the ability to pull directly in towards the middle. Even though the rework, the creep aggro, does make that almost next to, well, not impossible. If you take damage, then you'll pull the creep wave down. But it does make it very, very difficult. But it does look like Boomski's setting up. In fact, they're both going to double pull. Yeah, they both pull at the same time. So it'll be four creeps worth or four camps worth of farm for the Batrider. Then he can go top. So you're right.
Yeah, that's a nice move, definitely.
How is Nose looking here in the mid lane? Still trying to find a couple of souls. I think he's just wanting to use his mana before he loses it. Just missing his timing out a little bit here. Sindarin's really controlling him well. And it's not because he's taking away his mana and pulling him out of the creep wave. It's just Nose was forced to do that entire fight underneath the entire creep farm underneath the tier 1 tower, which is the worst position in the world for a Shadow Fiend to be at the early stages of the game before he's managed to pick up a couple of souls.
Yeah, especially with the denying power of this OD as well. They are denying creeps from Sindarin by pulling, but
Radiant's
still,
top
like you
tower
said,
is
last
under
hitting under that
attack.
tower is a task itself, and tier 1 on
Radiant's
top
top
already
lane
being
is under
pressured,
attack.
Glyph forced out there. Oh, the Keeper of the Light, in fact, is coming up here to defend. Spat was going to be spamming his Illuminate, just trying to hold that off a little. If he does get dived here, though, it could be trouble. Mantrim having a little search there, pushing past the tower a little bit.
That's a long way to dive to try and stop a Connor from doing what he's doing. The Bears, in fact, if Warlock didn't resummon just then, he would have lost and taken that extra damage to himself. But it's easy enough for Coddle. Like, he's still doing Shaka and then Blast. Dust Free can't be too aggressive. Same with Matrim. If they do catch him out, then sure, yeah, you got him. But he can cancel that Illuminate at any time. And it forces you off the lane. Just one hero is capable of doing that. Bane can't rotate and do that kind of stuff. And PL doesn't have to worry. Like, they don't have to worry about leaving him alone down there. Tulex can get in a little bit closer, sure, but then it's just land spam, force him back, continuous damage, force those consumables to come out from Tulex. And Strain B just controls the bottom lane. And Coddle can move back down again when the top lane feels in control or when Batrider feels safe enough to head up towards top. Which, by the looks of it, he doesn't want to leave. He's happy in the jungle.
Yeah, smoke up here from Nyx and the SD in their own forest, heading towards mid. But there is that Bane there at mid. That's who they're signaling. They want to take out that Bane. Get that support away from that mid lane. Let Syndra have that free lane again, because he is doing rather well up against the Shadow Fiend. 10 for 3 against 9 for 3. Equal-ish, but SF leading on levels, in fact, because of that pulling.
This is what has changed this lane around. The dynamic was going all the way Syndra. He was the one that was really winning this lane out. But then the pull happens in the mid, and this is something which you've got to be ready for. Like, it's difficult to stop, but like Dutch and Matrim, they're rotating out when they're over two levels. Like, we're sitting two levels and almost a half up on these guys now. It's very, very late for their rotation. I was waiting for it to come a lot earlier. Well, not even waiting, I was hoping for it to come a little bit earlier up on the nose before he gets this point where he's got 15 souls stacked up, he's already running bottle, and he's about to pop level 5. This is a little bit too late to initiate on a hero.
Yeah, and they smoked far too early as well. They smoked quite close to their tier 1 at top, and then had to traverse the whole of their jungle, wait around on mid lane a little bit for an opening, and then their smoke ran out. If they'd possibly gone up to the Radiant Ancient stack and tried to find an opening from that side, they may have been able to, but still.
Bane just found Matrim. They're walking right next to each other. There's a possibility for the Nightmare. Disruption will start off, and Coddle wants to catch up to him in time. And there goes the Coddle Blast. Matrim won't be able to avoid this one, even at the speed he's walking. Oh, he does. He's just got enough movement speed to get away, to get out of range of it. But it's still Boomski. Not deciding to brain set up Warlock's Bear. Even though it would have been really nice. That'd be 30 seconds that Bear wouldn't be there. But they get denial on the top tower, so life is okay.
Yeah, that denial is vital. Because MTW have been pushing that, really wanting that extra bit of gold for Matrim and Dutch Freak, who have not been stacking and pulling. They've been trying to force that tower. But getting that deny, that's so much gold down the drain for them. Time wasted, plus that smoke gang, which they didn't really do much with. But Syndra having a bit of a free time here now at mid, because Nose went off to find that rune.
It's also because the trees have respawned. So Boomski's pull in towards the middle lane requires another setup here from Krilly. But at this point, he's already taken care of his own double stack. In fact, he's going to go through three of them. It's just the speed of a Batrider jungle farm. And you'll get some really good levels out of this. I could see him jump up around three levels right now. But keeping the napalm stacks, using the end of their firefight. Oh no, he's gonna die to the neutrals. I can't. What the hey? Maybe biting off a little bit more than he could chew just there.
I saw that coming. The centaur wasn't slowed quite enough. Taking one last swipe and took him down. But yeah, the PL down on his bottom lane as well. 27 for 8, farming up quite nicely. I do wonder sometimes what he's going to go for. PL's, you know, they differ in their opinions on what item is strongest for their team composition to actually bring them through that mid game into the late game. We see Aoi go for that defusal into, you know, Heart or sometimes Radiance, possibly, if he's doing really well. Mm-hmm. What's the Brazilian team? Pain? Or have they changed sponsors recently?
No, they're still Pain Gaming.
Yep, they ran a Radiance straight away as well. But then there's other teams which just go for defusal into Manta, defusal into Heart.
Yeah. It's kind of like the two builds. Like, Link was also a guy who did it last night, where he went Radiance to start with. But you only normally go the Radiance build if you're getting no pressure whatsoever on your lane. And you're still feeling like the rhythm is there, like the last hit's there and it's not affecting you at all. Wow, Strain, but he's really forcing this one out. Windrun's the only thing saving Tulex right now. If that illusion was able to do its normal right clicks in, then that would have been the death of Tulex. He is an experienced Windrunner player. But yeah, Radiance or Diffusal in the Heart, that's the only two builds which most people are using. Maybe we'll see something new and funky come out from in the future, but for now, Diffusal or Radiance, either way.
Most efficient. I mean, Diffusal is a great mid-game item for that DPS output, and Radiance, obviously, farming item. We've seen that a lot. PL is basically the equivalent of the Naga now, just without that big shiny ulti that makes people fall asleep.
I don't want to say PL is no fun, man. I don't want to say PL is no fun. PL can be a lot of fun, depending on the way he's played. Depending a lot on the way he's played. And normally over here in Europe, it's a little bit more forceful. But we know Sindarin as far as being a captain. We know the way he used to play and the old MTW before they changed themselves around. And now we've got Dutch in here. We've got Warlog. We've got Matrim. Of course, Matrim being the old Wild Honey Badger coming back into the fold. And Tulex, who has always been really a part of MTW. Counterwarding. Who's going to get it first? Not Matrim. Man, that's commitment to D-warding. Straight out another sentry ward. First one doesn't work, don't worry. I got another up my sleeve. Yeah, but MTW are a team that they're no strangers to a long, drawn-out game. Matrim was already calling it at the very, very start. It's like, yeah, man, just be prepared. Like, this game's going to go for like maybe about 60 minutes time. You'll never know who's going to win, but it'll be 60 minutes in length. And then now we see Tabuski come back and D-ward. D-ward the sentry ward.
Yeah, length of the game. How is this bear doing, in fact? Midas, Boots, Stout Shield, and about 800 gold at 8 minutes. That's pretty decent.
Yeah, what's its gold? Its gold per minute is the highest on the field. It's higher than PL and SF. But Syndrome's falling behind here in the mid lane. Surely, and that's also, remember, with the bonus gold. It might not really seem like much, but we are still looking at, it was an extra 1,000 gold. That came the way of every single player, or not an extra 1,000 gold, extra 200 gold that came the way of every single player on MTW.
He's just constantly aware that that Bane could be right behind him. That Bane is constantly pulling, stacking, hiding on that ledge.
Oh, Dutch.
But they do have a ward up there now.
Is he still not level 6? Oh, and now Krilly's just like, sweet, you want to come out mana burn me? I'll Firefly, chase me if you dare. I think Warlog dares. Matrim definitely dares. Already started off with the disruption into catcher. Follow-up stun and the entangle. He can't get over the hill. And that's first blood. So many bat rides I've seen avoid death because they decide up on this top lane, I get ganked around here, and I just fly up into the tree line. And you can't even see where I draw the line because it technically doesn't exist on the map. But it jumps around the top and he's able to fly out of the map technically for a small amount of time. Well, technically he's not out of the map. It's just completely out of reach up in a hill.
Yeah, and that's a break MTW really needed there. Matrim is going to be able to afford dust, smoke. Yep, there we go, dust and some observers. So most likely they'll rotate down to the bottom lane, try and pick off that PL as quickly as they can. What's he sitting on? 2.5k, possibly Radiance we're looking at then. Because Tulex has been forced off that lane 3 times now. It's really not looking good for him. Especially when that Keeper of the Light comes back, forces him off. Gets that blast, PL lances as well, there's no way for him to escape, even with Windrun.
Yeah, we've been seeing him, I've seen him now 3 times, two times, make a run all the way back to base. That's because he's taking too much damage down here. Like, there's your lance, and if Tulex remained around and the Colossal Blast hit, that's almost all of his life gone, with just 2 abilities. But this is the power we know that is there from Coddle, and it's the reason why the Coddle PL lane used to be just so successful, because you had the burst damage out from both, and then you had the Chakra to help PL get all of his mana back so he can keep spamming lances out and not worry they'll be caught short. Because early on the stage, like, Doppelwalk is bloody expensive very early on. Like, 150 mana for a defensive ability. That's a lot to go through.
Yeah, I was quite interested earlier why he's maxed his Doppelwalk, seeing as he's up against this Windrunner, he's not really going to be using it. Maybe he's just afraid from the rotation from the MTW supports, which he's expected earlier. Are they going to dive this tier 2? No, they're just going to try and... Oh, Matrim, that's a lot of damage to take from that Illuminate.
I think early on too, he's not willing to push the lane out. Even if you create an illusion of yourself, you can't always control it. So it's just easier to level up the Doppelwalk instead. You can get the Juxtapose later on. Like, that's another 4 abilities. It'll be maxed out by 14. Well, obviously not, by 16 will be the point, but... He'll caught up and then go into stats onto that 15th point. That's not going to be a problem for him.
Often I just
feel Batrider. Hater on the trees. And then Lasso on Tulex. Just after he Windrun too. So Windrun only level 1, completely wasted. And that's going to be his death. Attempt to shackle but won't latch. And Quilly, nice rotation down.
Nobody expects the Batrider. Especially when they haven't seen him for most of the game. He wasn't top for long. He was in the forest, died to neutrals. Where's this Batrider been? And then, yep, there's the little drawing on the map from Tulex. Batrider came from here. I could do nothing.
Bat was here.
Bat was here. Yep.
Matrim. Let's think about this top lane. Coddle's the only one up here. Possibly the easiest initiation of his life. Disruption, catcher, Dutch Freak, follow-up stun. And then Warlock prepped the bear, but he didn't even have time to get a paw swipe in. Nyx destroyed him. So we hit our, well, that's our third kill for MTW.
That's going to be a nice timing for that relic as well. 12, almost 30 minutes in, and he's about 600 gold away from that relic. So nice timing for his Radiance as well, about 15 minutes in or so.
He's just a little bit behind though, because I'm seeing a relic flying down towards the bottom lane right now on our wild honey badger. Because he is wild, man. Who else would strap balloons to themselves? Only wild honey badgers do that.
And a fan or a propeller up their bum.
Yeah, that's just a little bit more uncomfortable than anything
else.
Awkward. I love how Simon Hayes is like, ooh, cutter blast, ooh, cutter blast, and walk here in the middle of your spy carapace.
I reckon that's one of the reasons Nyx has been picked up so often recently, is the buff to that carapace, taking multiple instances of damage rather than just one.
I still find it very amusing that Puppy during TI2, the reason why he picked it is because at that portion, I think he thought it worked on everything when it reflected out. That was his logic when he picked it, he said. And then it wasn't the case. So he was like, ah. Okay.
Unfortunate.
Okay. And then it got changed to be exactly what Puppy thought it should have been.
Yeah. He had a few words with Ice Frog. Like, come on, fix your stuff, man.
So Ice, meeting in person right now. You see this hero? This hero didn't win the game for me. Please change it so it would win the game for me. Even though the game is over. Doesn't matter.
Syndrome there. He imprisoned Nose on that Shadow Fiend. Nyx, with his ulti up, came around. Just out of time, though. Nose got up onto that cliff, got into the fog. Although they do have a ward up, an observer there, so they could see him. They just didn't want to go too far, not knowing where the Bane and Batrider are. And they are right behind that Shadow Fiend, as always.
Look for the opening, man. Matron's already trying to find one down here on the bottom lane. Looking for Strangby. He's just sitting top of the tower. That catapult, I think it's giving him more than enough vision to know where Strangby is. But then Krilly comes in from the side and goes, yo, guys, Matron's here. And Matrim does the same thing. That's why Boomski is hiding inside the tree line for the moment, but Shadow Poison always going to show that off. Still feel the bigger concern on the map for MTW is not just the fact that Batrider is out there and rotating around looking for kills, but it's the fact that Coddle is getting free farm. He's building up towards this mech now, but knows it's also, like, he's racking up his farm. He's now 1,300 away from the full BKB. And MTW have one ability, which is a chance ability, that will go through it. And that means that Nose will have free control over himself during the team fight.
They also have the Demonic Purge as well.
Oh, that's true. That's true. We have Purge on top of it. I always forget about Purge with Shadow Demon.
Yeah, it's an unusual one. But yeah, like you said, the Batrider, he hasn't really shown himself apart from that gang on bottom lane. He's been farming up the forest, almost Blink Dagger, 400 away from that. How's Bane doing? Something on the courier, or has he just been buying all the wards?
I think he's been buying 100% of the wards, man. It's just leaving the extra space and farm for the rest.
Tulex on bot. No, it's going to be the Keeper.
Yeah, Keeper, the light goes down. Shackle also lands up here on Strangby. They've got no vision that far down, though, so it's not going to help them.
They had dust on the Nyx. They could have gone for it, but Nyx didn't have the stun off cooldown, and I don't think they wanted to risk it. They don't know where the Batrider and Bane are. They're constantly worried about these guys. Because if they get caught out by that bat, the Nyx and the Shadow Demon are not going to have a happy time in one of those engagements.
Mm-hmm. And Nose, he wanted to go towards the top lane. I'm also a little bit surprised with Nose's build, because even though, like, whoa, it's BKB, it's not the normal item build of an SF. Not these days. These days, the normal item build is, in fact, a Shadow Blade. That's what we've been seeing here from so many SFs. So they can be more aggressive. They can find these openings. And they can roll with the punches. It's just got a little bit more defensive up here against the MTW lineup.
Yeah, he's really worried about the DPS coming out of Syndra, and I think if he wants to wind up his ulti, he doesn't want to be 3 or 4 hit by Syndra after a stun from Nyx.
But with the damage you get from Shadow Blade, he can also, like, 2 or 3 hit Syndra. You come out of it, you come out with your ultimate as well. Because that's the beauty of Shadow Blade. The beauty of Shadow Blade is you can pop it, you release your ultimate, and there's only like maybe like a 0.25 seconds, I think I remember it being, like time between where you get revealed and when your ultimate has a full effect.
With Shadow Fiend, Shadow Blade actually has an interesting interaction with his ultimate. You don't get revealed until it actually fully winds up and releases the souls.
So it is a full release? Because I was just saying, like, it should be, I thought it was like 0.25 seconds or something like that. Warp Blink Lasso. Syndrome, surprise, butt sex in the middle lane.
Yeah, Batrider. Does he have his blink? Yes, he does.
Yeah, and double damage up on Nose made that a very quick thing. And then TP straight up towards the top lane. Bane's the one in here. Stars up on the Fiend's Grip on Warlock. That bear has got to get an entangle. So he goes on to the Keeper of the Light, and then in comes SF. Double kill for him after getting the first big one in the middle, and then over to Lone Druid, the big guy on the top.
TP in, recall, Shadow Fiend with DD. That bear had no chance. He was hoping, oh, I've got Radiant's bear. I'm going to get entangled. I'm going to get away. But nope, two extra heroes appear on that tier 2, and then they deny it as well.
Only downside is they're going to lose their T1 tower in mid. MTW will take that. Coddle Blast. Hey! Would you believe what was just purchased? Booyah Kacha. And that's going to be Krilly. Well, disrupted up for a moment. And the catcher attempting, but doesn't latch on the real one. And then Batrider, yep, they're set to deny him in a lane.
Three deny towers.
And MTW just can't finish the job. Did SF sell his... No, he just bought a straight... He just bought the straight Shadow Blade.
Yes. He has made a lot of money in the past 5 minutes or so.
I like it, man. I like it. This is what I just...
Proving your point for you.
Yes! Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Yeah, you go, SF. You get in there. I give him three clicks. Actually, it might be a little bit harder on Sin now because Sindarin's bought himself an Ogre Club. So he's managed to rack over 1,000 HP. And then Sentry Wards go down... Syndarin's really not sure about this at all. Because the Shadow Blade's a surprise. Now moving back. And now he's in vision. Well, at the same time, Batrider. Whoa, hello, bottom lane. Entangle and Shackle up on the PL. They've already lost two. And SF will go inside his Shadow Blade again. Looking at Warlog to start with on the bottom. Getting Radiance burned up, and then Sentry Wars down by the Dire side. They see Nose if he comes up. But just PL and Batrider, did you catch that one with them getting caught out? Or are you waiting for the kill in mid lane too?
I was waiting mid as well. I caught the very end of it down at bottom lane, but that was just both of them dying at the same time.
Nightmare up on the bear, and look at Nose. He's winding up. Three heroes, everyone next to him. Two legs, one raise, and right click, but the wind run won't hit because of that. Or the right click won't hit because of that. And then Shadow Fiend. Mana leaked up. That entangle is really doing its job up on Nose. They've got to get rid of this bear. He's such a nuisance. And now Syndarin jumped himself in, gets the ulti off. Only kills off the Bane, however. And then coming out, Batrider giving time to blink away. And Shadow Fiend on the run as fast as possible away from that engagement. He was so lucky to be out of range of Syndarin's ulti then.
And we have a mech up on Tulex as well. Suddenly appears in his inventory, and then he gets arcanes on top of it. So coming out of that bot lane where he had a really rough time, he has not done badly for himself.
No, he has not. Love to do the fact this Essence Aura is such a huge buff. TP support's coming down right now. And as PL instantly inside a double walk, the sentries are there, and Krilly really low on life, forced up, and then Syndarin just destroys him. Oh, straight in the Batrider, Shackle holding Boomski in position. Disruption, maybe that wasn't the best time to do that. They want to kill him off before Nose comes in, but now he realizes, smack bang in the middle of a sentry warden, Syndarin. It was actually the lone druid that finishes the job, then moves over to Boomski. Two down the sidelines, now onto Strangby. Goes invis for the moment, he's out of range. Power Shot's just having a fish. Dyer's middle tower and Dutch on low life. Are we looking at Strangby looking for an opening?
No, he's got a lone druid bear. Tier 2 tower of the Radiant. Go on, keep on chasing.
He doesn't want
to. You can do it.
Ezalor would kill him. Like Windrunner was hoping for that to be the real Strangby, but it's not. He popped the salve. With this Radiance, he can slow this bottom lane down, but we're seeing that pure damage that's coming out from MTW. That's really damn high. And now Radiance burn, Tulex, he won't die on this one. In fact, they just turn around and Strangby, he's gone in solo.
That was a questionable decision.
Yes.
Because we saw earlier down at that tier 1 tower, Dutch Freak dived past the tower, turned on Carapace, and the Radiance Burn actually procced it, so the PL got stunned himself. Dutch Freak decided not to carry on going for that because he didn't have any reveal on him, so the PL ran away. But coming back in again and doing the same thing again, getting stunned by the Carapace, which is such a strong skill up against the Radiance, because he can't do anything about it unless he turns it off, obviously. But yeah, going back in, 1v5, he's got some balls.
Man, there's something amusing about an OD who's walking around with 4 points up an Essence Aura and not getting any procs off it. Like, the restore chance of 40%. He got so little of it, but the regen rune was keeping him up the entire time. Right, I just found that slightly ironic with Essence Aura.
RNG, why? Essence Aura hasn't changed over to the pseudo-random, has it? I don't believe it has. It's mainly the evasions and crits that have done that so far.
Yeah. It's not the chance ability thing that... No, it hasn't. Man, how much damage can you do with one orb hit? Take away 200 life points of the PL. Quilly and Nose are waiting on the top lane. They want Warlord to come a little bit further out of range of the tower, but if there's a lasso, and now he's right next to him. Now, no need for a wind-up, just right-click it. What the hell?
Entangle.
What the hell? And then the Shackle from Tulex, a perfect Tulex execution. And Nose winds up the ulti, but he'll only have the one from death. That's not the real. What was the chance of the first pause swipe?
That's ridiculous. Better right, it blinks in, I'm going to lasso this bear, and then SF's going to kill him with his ultimate, and then, oh, I'm entangled by roots, and I'm going to die now.
Strikebeat's going to take out the T1 tower in mid. Are we going to see this one denied? Syndrome's going to come in. Deny it? Yep. So, there's been one tower that hasn't been denied. Strikebeat's dead in the middle. Mad Trip tried to come in and help on that one, almost got himself killed. But it's just that, it's the bottom tower. Was it both the bottom towers, actually, from MTW when they pushed it? No.
Correct. Yes, none of the bottom towers were denied. Both top ones were, mid one, tier one was, and for the Radiant. So there are three towers in the game which weren't denied. Oh. Two of them MTW took, and one of them which 4FC took.
Goodbye, Boomski. Entangled and held. He only did that so the rest of his team can get out to safety, aka one player. But that's PL and Bane on the sidelines now.
Another one!
No tower shall be easily earned. They shall be denied at every single turn.
No tower shall stand.
What is this, Stronghold? Very good game until they destroyed it.
Yeah, I played the original and then I sort of felt no need to play the others.
Well, it's because they made everything so complicated, man. It never needed to be complicated, it was just so simple. That was the beauty of it.
It was like, put down tar traps, set them on fire, your enemies die.
Exactly. Perfect. Works. Magical.
Full cuirass now on that lone druid. He's got a lot of gold.
Man, I love the fact you even know the old strats from Stronghold. That's great. Are we walking around with Gem? Yeah, we got a Gem up on Dutch now. He is search. They're dewarding, and 4FC just went blind. 4FC just went completely blind. They've got no ward outside of their base. Obviously, no wards inside their base either, but that's not the point.
The towers count.
No. Towers don't count. A stationary ward does not count in my analysis. But Coddle Blast counts as far as to counter pushing against MTW. But they should know all about this. But then again, we've got Syndrome wanting... What the hell is happening with that dragon?
It is twitching a little bit.
It's a rave!
That's my spot. That's
my spot. It's a rave! Lifting some Daft Punk while being farmed up. It's the way to go, man. It's the way to go. Dino alone drawing his bear. Syndrome could possibly two hit the Bane. Possibly. He does have an extra 1,000 mana than him.
3.5 hits, maybe. Matrim dies on top. What?
Yeah, SF initiation with Shadowblade, and then very fast TP out. Feels the radiance, but at the same time, Krilla getting called out by Syndrome. Man, the crap was that?
Goodbye, Bat Rider.
That was overkill. That was no faith in Dutch Freak's stun. That's what that was. Puts it on cooldown. It's not even a question of mana. It's got Essence Aura, so it's not a question of mana.
Look at Bane. He's dewarding again. Yeah, he found some gold somewhere.
But he's going to lose all of his wards anyway, because they'll know the fact that he dewarded it and then go down there with the NA Gem and Windrunner. And now we've got Windrunner. Tulix is trying to defend up against PL Illusions. The never-ending army. Until Cinderin comes in, at which point it's ended. Nose, ulti wind up. He's looking at Warlock. Can't finish the job. Warlock's already retreating.
I don't think he can kill him.
Well, what's Warlock walking around with? It's just got normal boots and ulti form.
That ulti form, though, 2,157 hit points.
And then, of course, the aura of the bear when he recalls him back in again. Yep. It's a full AC up on the bear. And Cinderin's now racking up more intelligence and going for the Scythe of Ice. Started off with the ultimate orb, though. Kind of surprising. Thought he might have gone as the Mystic Staff, but I might be feeling a little bit too much pressure. But he definitely wants to push this out. How long until Roshan... In fact, the Aegis is reclaimed in 30 seconds time. He may as well just die now. No, he's going in for it. He knows the timing. He's like, please initiate on me. I have the will to die. Coddle Blast might give him the wish. Tower in the middle lane. It gets a 9!
No.
Coddle's on it! Coddle is on it! Bottom tower is under attack. At the same time, top lane, what do we got? Shadow Fiend destroys the tower up there, so that one won't be denied. And he finishes up his full BKBs. Now with Shadow Blade plus the BKB. Shadow Blade not working out the same way that I thought it would have.
Well, Warlock. When that big one is Radiance, the two supports started
Warlock,
falling.
Warlock's in trouble. Warlock's in a lot of trouble. Dutch Freak's behind him. There goes our disruption. Flame Break doesn't push him up towards the high ground. Matrim, he is held in position for the moment. Batrider entangled and the Coddle Blast. Matrim goes down. PL in position again. Spike Carapace, pain in the butt, and then Nyx finishes the job. Quick hit in and out of Vendetta, then turns around for the Sun on Boomski, and then Cinderin forced arm Sin to try and get that one, but Warlock will ensure he takes the kill, the glory. This is exciting. And SF and Coddle are the only ones to get out of that one alive. For the price of what? A Shadow Demon?
Yep. And that whole engagement started because Bane counter-warded, MTW came to counter the counter-wards, and then everyone started fighting and, you know, having a bitch fight, and like, stop counter-warding my counter-wards, and you stop counter-warding my counter-wards to your counter-wards. And then people died. Only the Shadow Demon on the other side, though. But that Carapace is really proving to be troublesome. Inside the Firefly, Carapace. Near the Phantom Lancer's Radiance, Carapace. Near the Shadow Fiend when he's winding up his ultimate, Carapace. Near the Coddle Blast, Carapace, you lose half your health.
And you wonder why NA is banned?
Yeah.
Wonder no more. Wonder no more. This is exactly the reason why. And we're now 30 minutes on the clock. We know Roshan spawns up in about 2 minutes and a half. MTW, they've already taken all the outer towers, and they won't push it until they have themselves another Aegis up on Cinderin. And that's buying time now for Windrunner. She buys full 4-star, so Tulix... 4-star for Mech, Matrim walking around with Tranquil Boots, and that's all. Dutch Freak, 4-star up on him with the Gem and Arcanes. They're even though they have a Gem, they're still throwing down sentries. They want to see when the real PL moves. And all props to 4FC for also trying to deward when there's a Gem on the other side.
Also, knowing that MTW is in their forest, most likely trying to chokehold the gold income. Shadow Fiend farming that top lane pretty safely, and they know that they're going to be running around as 5 MTW ever since the sort of 17, 18 minute mark. Bear got his Radiance up. Shadow Demon and Nyx have followed him around, tried to move around with him, keeping him safe most of the time.
Yep.
And that's one of the reasons that Shadow Blade really hasn't worked out so great, because he wants to go and try and 2-3 hit the Shadow Demon, get that Nyx, maybe wind up an ulti near a Windrunner. But he hasn't been able to. That bear has been constantly with his supports, keeping them safe as they've kept him safe.
The beauty of it is, though, he can push out in the side lanes, not fear as much. Because you know you can just jump in, Viz, and if you're smart enough, you can juke it around. Even if they have vision with the gem, the bonus movement speed you get, it allows you to either chase or initiate or run away. Either way. It can do 3 different things. And then Coddle can just pull you out. You go invis, don't get attacked. And Coddle's recall will pull you in. So you can push out the top lane all the way to the tier 2 tower and not have to use your TP to come back. Just have Coddle pull you in. Just don't take that damage.
The trouble is going to be if he pushes slightly too far, if he has to waste one of those BKB charges, which he will need in these upcoming fights. He's really going to need those BKB charges for these fights up against the OD, because that OD does a lot of damage. How far away is he now from his hex? Not far at all. Was it 400 gold away from it?
I'm going to do the 2700, and then you got 500 of the 800 required. Basically, kill on Roshan, and he's got Scythe of Ice. And would you believe, Roshan respawns exactly the same time as Sindarin TP's in MTW. They've got the stopwatch on the side. And now they'll open up on Rosh. He's already, I say open up, he's already down at one third, like 1/8, and now zero. And Sindarin takes it, and then buys... Oh, he's just short.
Wait, Ancients?
I thought he was going to have enough. Yeah, Ancients could have been it. But he's not. He bought a TP.
What's he gonna...
For some reason he bought a TP and now he's gonna go inside the jungle. Obviously he's, well, you should never underestimate the importance of a TP. But it means he's gonna move up towards that top lane and get that farm. At this point, still about 20 short, which is gonna be a little bit frustrating, but he sees Nose up here. And then, oh, nice get out by Matrim. Used the poison, knew someone else had to be here, and it was Krilly. He's perched up, slowed up, Dutchreek running right through the middle of the Firefly, but the Shackle will allow him to one remaining tree. And there goes the Batrider. And there's your Scythe device. Well, the remaining part of it flying out now to send.
Yep, but having to defend their tier one, tier two at top because of that Shadow Fiend push with Batrider behind. PL obviously has got free reign of his own forest, sending all those illusions out, being able to farm up there with little to no micro needed whatsoever. Just a move into the forest with those illusions. They'll split themselves up, farm all that gold you need, while the real one works on the lane and pushes that out. But MTW pushing down that top lane, five man full force.
They're still going to push into a Coddle Blast, SF Razors, and then the Disables of Bane. This is their problem. Like, we come towards the front lines, they don't have much of a creep wave, the bears are nightmared up, and Cinderin comes a lot of damage coming in, but he pops the BKB, Nose trying to right-click him down, there's that damage you're looking for on Cinderin. Dutch Freak also just being completely critted to death. And now Cinderin comes back up again, but Lassoed in way too deep. They pop off the SF ult, he's already used his BKB, holding himself fat in his own imprisonment. One raise at the wrong timing here by Nose, tries to fall with a right-click, 15 HP. Batrider will end the stream. That's worth 571. Tulex forced back out again. They will lose the top racks, but Dutch Freak almost had to bring down the PL. Oh, an entangled paw swipe. So that's the job for Warlock. Now he goes beyond godlike, looking for one on Krilly. Resummons the bear. He gets it too. Double kill. Move over onto the SF. Knows they find him. SF Aldi in death will pop. But the gems on the deck, the entire team of 4FC were just completely wiped. But it is going to be double buyback as well to repel out that top.
Melee Rax was worth it for Sindarin's life. And you could almost hear Sindarin saying, Rax, Rax, just get the Rax. Let me die, get the Rax and run. As soon as they took that Melee Rax, all of MTW turned around, but 4FC wanted to continue pressing. That bear just turns around, entangles, kills the PL, kills the Batrider, forces buyback from Shadow Fiend, gets the Ranged Rax as well. Everything after that Melee Rax was just bonus for them.
I'm happy with it, man. Force buybacks, what are we looking at now? Advantage 20,000 going the way of MTW as far as experience goes, and gold 14k going their way with 8 to 24. And how much of it's coming through CS? It's still amusing to see that both PL as well as SF are the kings of the CS board, 262 and 261, and then you've got the Lone Druid as well as the OD. But the difference in the gold per minute is because coming through, well, not only the towers, which have been claimed by MTW, because at this point they're currently four towers up, but also the fact they have taken so many kills. So the gold per minute Lone Druid is leading the way at 653 gold per minute. And that's coming through the 11 kills and the 5 assists for the one death that he has had. And now Dutch is going to kill Nose. Sees him, Vendetta, and then stun. He doesn't have dust. Stun's going to be there. Mana burn it out, and now he's so close to Shadow Blade and he can't get it off in time. Cinderin with three clicks does the job. The Hex follow through very, very quickly.
I mean, CS tells one story, but Net Worth and that Abyssal on the Bear tells a complete another.
It's a full Abyssal?
Yep.
The really funny thing is, though, he can't trigger it.
Correct.
If he sold the Stalshield and bought a Point Booster, he can trigger it. They should be transferring this too. Wow, PL soloing SD on the bottom lane. It's amazing what happens when you have a lot of PLs on your side. Nen throws in another Lance. Just keep that pressure going. Added towards that bottom lane. Buyback will be there by the Shadow Demon, but Matrim is still as useless as he was before. It's the middle lane which is being pushed out. Coddle Blast can hit pretty nice and hard. Blinding Light trying to force him back for a bit as well. And then Flamebreak repositioning them all. Cooley, however, hexed up. Two hits by Cinder. Then the ulti. And there goes your Batrider. Instantly forced to buy it back. Tower's doing a lot of damage to Tulos, not to mention that Mana Leak doing its job as well. He runs completely out, but they'll give him an Urn Charge. But they took the melee racks, and they took the range racks, and the tower. They took the whole mid. Well, Cooley's looking for another opening, trying to justify his buyback, but it's just not there.
I think Matrim bought back just to get his gem. The gem was sitting between the melee and range racks, and he was scared that Phantom Lancer was going to come in and steal it, so he bought back to take his gem back.
Yeah, because that's obviously the reason.
Obviously!
Always protect those gems. Always protect the gems. They're like the family jewels.
Don't be rude.
I'm not being rude, man. I'm talking about jewelry!
Of course you
What
are
you talking about, bloody English people that have different
jewelry,
different meanings for family jewels? How many times has the Queen said, I'm going to polish my family jewels? Like, wait, the Queen shouldn't have family jewels. Yeah. Yeah. So that's why the English language is destroyed.
Because of us English people.
Exactly. Exactly. You have destroyed the English language.
Four men smoked up 4FC in their own forest, trying to look for a loop round. But MTW holding that high ground now. Just going to soft push a little while until they know where 4FC are hiding.
The really hilarious thing is 4FC can still win this because they still have the power of a counter-pushing PL and the Coddle to pull them back in again. So you can always split push. Blink out, last two, four-star, pull them in, and there goes the SD. Or maybe not. Disruption buys a little bit of space. Knows he's stunned up that Abyssal Blade. It is job bashing through, and then the Entangle up on Krilly. Syndrome will get the double kill, but really, Warlog is the playmaker in this one. Triple kill for the captain of MTW. But Warlog's bear, most valuable player. And there goes the tier 3. Well, fortification will slow him down a little bit. PL's come back into the fight. But it's a little bit too late for him to rejoin it. It's going to be mega creeps going the way of MTW. And what should be the GG call as well. Which leaves us with one last game, man. One last game. When in mood, we'll be going up against the Brazilians. Next Impetus, will be coming up pretty shortly after this game. This game happening probably a little bit faster than a lot of people expected, waiting for an hour and two. But never hit that point. Well, go Nose. Go Nose.
Aww.
He attacked Dutch Freak, the little spike carapace, and gets instantly held there. Oh, well done, Tulex. Windrun's letting him evade a little bit, but Fiend's Crypt ensures his death. But that is GG. That is the game over, and quite convincingly so. Quite convincingly so. MTW never really looked like they were behind. Could look like they could have been pressured though. Like that SF really could have pressured a lot more, but Syndrome really controlled the lane early on. Mid-pull helped out a little bit, but rotation came at the right time. And it worked perfectly.
Yeah, MTW looked a little bit shaky early on, but they did really bring it together very, very nicely during the mid-game. The Phantom Lancer and the Shadow Fiend, as you said, they look like they could be holding that game together for 4FC. But a few mistakes and a few very nice movements from MTW really pulled through for them.
Yeah, and that keeps MTW's hopes alive for the top seeding. Of course, it now also opens up both third and fourth position, and also possibly opens up the second position there, because if 4FC ended with 6-1, then it was basically going to lock the top two as 4FC as well as Team Tick and Tusk. But with now them finishing up their defense Group B stage, they will go into, 5-2. Out of the seven games they got to play, they had to go 5-2 in their matchup. And that means now MTW with 3-2 have a significant chance. If Team Empire drop their one of their next games, then they have a chance. They've only got two more games, Team Empire, then MTW might be able to get themselves into the upper bracket. But for right now, guys, we're going to go to ourselves to a short break, and we'll be back with Brazil next Impetus. They will be going up against whim, when in mood. They don't actually have a country. They're everywhere. They're everything. We'll be back. We'll be back. More defense coming up shortly.
I said good day, sir!